אני אני מאוד אני תודה גילת, אני מאוד אוהב את השאלה.
אני חושבת שהתחילה עם הכי פחות תהיה, אני חושבת
שזה נשמע. וואה, לא זוכר, מתי שאלת כל כך הרבה שאלות
מהרצאה, זה היה מאוד מגניב. אני אקח את זה כטוב. סאבמישנס לסטור. זה הרבה ביחד בדרך כלל.
רגע, זה עם הרמות שמסכים על המספר?
וואו, זה המון.
הם מוסיפים באינדקס.
זה יחס של 20%.
זה מגיע ל-470, אבל אני חושב שזה...
לא, אני חושב סאבמישנס
מוגדר, שאין לי 100 ומה. 38, יש לי 40. לנפות. זה ביט, נכון? עושים PCP, נכון? יש לך היסטוריה עם PCP. לא ראיתי 370 אמרים ב-ECC למשל בחצי שנה האחרונה.
תצא שיהיה לך כאילו כזה...
נכון, יש... ארכייב צריך לסכן. אחוז לא סביר את זה. עכשיו זה... אני מרגיש שזה הוגן. נכון. זה מרגיש הוגן בינתיים. כל מאמר רגשתי נגיד פעמיים, בדקתי יותר. יותר מ... 25 או משהו. אבל הייתי עם אופר, אז מה זה אומר? אני לא יודע איך לחשיב את זה גם. טוב, לא יודע. אולי אפשר למצוא את זה ולהתייחס. yeah. Oh, hi. With this optimistic point of view. So the theorem that we set out to prove today is constructing Ramsey graphs, but we already yesterday translated this problem to the problem of constructing dispersers. And since I don't want you to assume that you remember what's a disperser, this is just essentially the definition inside the theorem. So the theorem that we will prove is, you know, that we will construct an efficiently computable function, function that's evaluated in time poly n. With the property that if you feed these functions a sample from two independent sources with sufficient entropy, sufficient here is log n to some constant power, I don't know what exactly that constant is, then what you'll get is this random variable that it's non-constant, that is non-constant. So this is what we set out to prove. Before going into the details, let me just make a small review from what we will need from yesterday. So it actually starts here. So, yeah. So just a reminder, so x is a k-source, we use this definition in the theorem. So x is called a random variable, x is called a k-source if it has entropy k, mean entropy k, in the sense that you never see a point with probability larger than 2 to the minus k. And we also consider this stronger notion of k-block source. So what's a k-block source? So you take a random variable x and you split it to two, say in the middle, x1, x2. So we say that this is a k-block source if the first half is a k-source and conditioned on any fixing of this first half. The second is also a k-source. So it's it's not two independent sources, but it's something in the middle. And the reason we are so interested in block source is because it allows you to, is this theorem, but this theorem exists because block source allows you to work with sources in some sense as if they were at some level independent. And this is a theorem by Lee. The conclusion of a long line of research about constructing this thing. So this is not a, this is a great result. And what Lee proved is that there exists an efficiently computable function, which we'll call a block extractor. So this function gets two samples from weak sources, from sources, and outputs a bit. And the guarantee is that, you know, if you give it as a first the first sample is coming from a block source for some fixed poly log n entropy, and the second sample is coming from an independent poly log n source, it doesn't have to be a block source, then the output is unbiased or close to being unbiased. And in fact, we will use this, we'll need something stronger than that that Lee also has done. We need this thing to output many bits, not just one. Even though at the end we are really interested in only output one bit for Ramsey, for the purpose of constructing Ramsey graphs, we will actually need it to output many bits. And then the guarantee is that the output is statistically close to uniform. Right, so. Yeah, so it's essentially linear in the entropy of the sources. 0.9, if you can. No, omega of the entropy, you can make it. You can make it also 0.9, but then. Okay. So, and also the error is very important for us. I mean, I don't want to get into this, but it is important for us that the error is very small. It's essentially exponentially small in the entropy. So if the entropy is k, and this is like k's, I mean, as long as k is larger than some fixed poly log n, you can have m, which is omega of k, and error, which is something like almost optimal. I mean, the omega should sit here, I guess, but it's exponentially small in k. So this is why I'm allowing myself to completely ignore the error throughout the talk, because I'm not lying here. The error is small enough so that this is fine. Okay, so you can forget about the error, assume it's completely uniform from my perspective. Okay, so this is a great theorem that we will use as a key component, but in a black box manner. And so like orthogonal to that, we'll also discuss these notions of a subsource. So we say that X prime is a subsource of a source X if it's really just X condition on X sitting in some event. And the best way to imagine it, as we said, is, you know, X is uniformly distributed. It's not the most general thing, but you can just assume that X is uniformly distributed over some set, and A is a subset of that support. And so X prime is just uniformly distributed over subsets of the support of X.
The language of the matrices that you used
last time. Exactly. Right. Just taking some subset. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. But keep in mind that this is not really the theorem that I'm stating are not true if you take these notions, but we won't see it. It's indistinguishable given the lecture, so it's important for us. But this is how we should think of it. This is the right way to think about it.
No, it's true that whenever you take any Heidemann matrix, then a random submatrix of it of square root n by square root n is Ramsey.
Right.
Right.
I see. Okay. So I can't speak for Avi and his co-authors, but I think that the notion of subsources came up because you can guarantee things only on subsources in general.
Yeah, no,
but I don't know.
It's a very interesting fact that it's completely unrelated because you start here already with the very
You even mentioned me once. Yeah, also yeah. Okay. Also, we also be interested to some extent in the deficiency of a subsource. So we say that. So how much of a subsource is a subsource? So the deficiency of a subsource X prime of X is just really the kind of the density of x prime in x, just minus log to base 2 of the probability of x sitting in A. So for example, if A is half the support of x, the deficiency of the 1. If it's 1 quarter, it's 2, etc. And we just have this short notation to say that x prime is a deficiency in this subsource of x. Okay, you think of it as a subset of size 2 to the minus d, of density 2 to the minus d inside x.
But in all the applications of this, d will be small compared to the entropy you have. So it's
right, exactly. Okay, but I'll point that out in a second. Okay, so given these notions, so how there's notion of a block source and notion of a subsource, and the way we kind of combine them is the following. So this is the following lemma from BRSW, and it says that, you know, as long as k is larger than log square of n, also take any parameter b that is smaller than k over 2, then you have the following property. If x is a k source, which could be kind of adversarial and arbitrary, you may not be able to say something interesting about it, but you can always say that there exists a deficiency 2 subsource inside x prime, such that one of the following holds. So either x prime is a b block source, think of b as like square root of k or something like that. It's enough to work with, but not too much to kill the original source. So either x prime is a b block source, which is great, or otherwise, essentially, one of the halves, prefix or suffix of x prime, is a k minus b source. And again, I'm thinking of b as little of k, so when I see this, I think of k in my head. Okay, so either x1 prime is a k minus b source, or conditional any fixing, but even if you fix a prime 1, still x prime 2 is a k minus b source. So again, intuitively, either the entropy is kind of spread nicely between the two halves, or one of them still holds the entropy. And if you, as we did yesterday, if you applied it repeatedly, you can show that as long as k is slightly larger than log square of n, any k source, yeah, so this is kind of informal, but any k source x has a deficiency 2 log n. We ran it for log n iterations, and every time we lose 2 in the deficiency, has a deficiency 2 log n subsource x prime that has a t structure. For some entropy 3, so I did it in kind of because I didn't define it, with entropy k over log n. So what do I mean by that? So I mean that, you know, in any source x, you can find this x prime that has the following guarantee on it, the following structure. With x prime, you can associate a tree, a complete rooted binary, tree. It's really a path, but okay. So,
you always have both either on the left or on the right.
Yeah, and algorithmically, we actually start with a complete tree. So this is how, in my head, I always see the edges that I don't draw. But, this is just a path, really. What's the connection between this and this x prime? So you are guaranteed that first of all, you associate with every node in the tree some subset of the indices in the natural way. So with this node, you associate all the indices. And with this node, you associate just the half left of the indices and then the right half. And you continue recursively this way. And when you look at this tree, this tells you the fact that you have an f here for fixed. It tells you that the left side of x prime is fixed. Okay. And when you see high, it means that the corresponding part of x has high entropy. How high? It's this number here. It's actually almost k in this, but okay. And you continue this way, and once you see a b, it means that actually, if you look at the block that you're looking at, then this is a block source with this entropy. So, I mean, there are not enough entropy trees, just by counting arguments, there are not enough entropy trees so that every k source will have this nice structure. But nevertheless, any k source has a low deficiency, 2 log n is not much, subsource that has a very nice structure. There is some tree that kind of represents the entropy of the source in this sense. Okay, so this is what we did yesterday. Yeah.
So what happened is the condition on all the fixing, this leaf is a block source?
Mm-hmm. On any fixing.
Yeah, so I really think of it as fixed. It's really like a convex combination of these guys, but I really think of it as fixed.
This is the block zone.
Yeah, and these are high entropy.
On the thing
of the right here, yeah, you have no idea. It may be like identical to this or fixed, but you can never go there. I mean, you try to find the block source, so it just goes where the entropy is until you find it. So if you know that there's enough entropy in the left, you never go to the right. I mean, the way we do it. Okay. So yesterday we said something about, you know, let's find a block. Use XY to find the blocks inside X, such that X restricted to that block is a block source, and then apply least extractor. This kind of the high level idea. Now I want to kind of phrase it properly. But before doing that, let me just say two things. I'll just say it, I won't even write it. So we also said, right, that you know, for constructing dispersers, it's enough to move from X and Y to X prime and Y prime that are convenient for you and work there. Right, so this is what you're doing here. We actually completely ignore X, and we'll actually denote X prime by X from now on, where X prime has this tree structure. Right, if we want to construct a disperser, it's enough to be non-constant on subsources. But it's not the end of it. So this X prime is kind of simple. X prime is determined only by the distribution, underlying distribution of X. And I mean, we will continue on moving to subsources and subsources for other analysis. And the subsources should be functions of both sources. It would be kind of more complicated. But in any case, we will always kind of assume that the tree remains the same tree. In the sense that, you know, we move to subsources, X double prime of X prime. And we'll just think of the same tree, and we can do that. I just want to say it once and never repeat this thing, because the deficiency that we'll move to is very low compared to K over log n. And what you can show is that if you move to a deficiency D subsource of a K source, you're a K minus D source. OK, deficiency D subsource of a K source. Let me just write it out. So here are two facts that allows me to kind of, okay. So one, if X prime is a deficiency D subsource of X, and X prime is a K source, sorry, and X is a K source, then X prime, this is by definition, is a K minus D source. And if D is really small compared to K, then it's essentially a K source, is what I'm saying. And the same holds for block source up to some lie. So if K is a block source, let me just write it this way from now on, block source, then X prime is essentially K minus D block source. You're actually close to being that thing, but let's ignore that fact. So what do I mean? So if you have X prime that has this tree structure, and then you move to a low deficiency subsource, then every time you see a high node with high entropy, H stands for high, it still has high entropy, but slightly less high. And every time you see the fixed, of course, remains fixed when you move to low deficiency subsources. You just move to smaller thing, it's also fixed. And the B is a block source with a slightly weaker parameter. So the tree remains the same tree. If you make sure that the deficiency, if you take the deficiency to be very large, then of course the tree structure can change. But if it's small compared to the entropy, then you can assume it's the same tree all along. Okay, so this is what I'm saying, a tree, and I move to subsource and I forget about changing the tree because it's never actually changed. Just the parameter of the tree changes. Is this clear? I mean, okay, so with this, we are ready to actually say what's the three steps of the algorithm of this function. So it has three steps. Let me do it kind of informally and then more formally. So in first step, which is essentially mimicking BRSW, but we need to slightly overcome some technical issues, but it essentially was done in BRSW. A bit before that, I needed to do something before. Excuse me. So what we said is that we have, I'll get back to the steps in a second, I forgot a step on the way. So what we said is that we have this source X that has a tree structure, which we call T sub X. Okay, actually, this is kind of X prime inside X, but we forget about X already. So we call this X now. Otherwise, we'll have so many primes. You want like order of log n primes. So we have to do it this way. Right, with X, there is associated some tree of entropy, and it has this structure, and you know, it's really like Avishai said, it's really more of a path than a tree. And at some point, you have a node that is labeled by B, in this sense. And what we really want to do is to find this B and just apply the block extractor with X B and Y, with X on that block and Y.
You know which block, and you
yeah. Exactly. So unfortunately, in order to find this block, we won't actually find this block. But in order to find this block, we will have to have more structure from the source. So what we'll have to have, and when I think of it, maybe this is a picture to keep, so I'll do it here. What we'll have to have is let's call this V top, this node V top. We will also need that the left block of VTOP, right, VTOP is a block source. There is no symmetry in the block source. The left block has a different behavior than the right one. So I really care about the left block here. So I'm looking at the left block. It's now it's some K source, right? K over log n source or something. So I don't want it to just be a K over log n source. I want it to have the same tree structure as well. So I want it also to have somewhere inside of it a block source. So I'm just applying the same corollary again on this block and kind of glue it in. You need to be slightly careful when you do that.
So VTOP is the node with B.
Yeah, this is the node labeled right. Node labeled by B. But let's just call it VTOP.
Expand B now.
Yeah.
The left side.
The left side, yeah. So I'm going to the left side. Yeah, exactly. And I'm finding a subsource of deficiency 2 log n inside of it that you know also has this path, and you can show, you need to be slightly careful, but you can show that you can kind of glue it in. So this subsource induces a subsource of the whole thing, such that this is a block source and this is a block source. Okay, so BRSW also needed this extra structure of two things. They had a nice tension between these two blocks. Anyhow, it's kind of hard to explain in a second, but. Yeah, right. So this is the B that you get when you apply this lemma on the left, on the node corresponding, on the block corresponding to this node. Right. And it turns out that this remains a block source. I mean, it doesn't kill the block sourceness of it.
What a little B next to it?
Okay. Very small, so that it's. okay. Yeah, so every time, here from something that I never moved.
You're not really,
here you fix things.
It's
an important thing to make sure that.
Efficiencies are much smaller than one.
Right, and this is why it works.
Because of the fact.
Yeah, exactly. The fact tells you that if this is smaller than k, now it's like square root of k, and then to be k to the fourth power. Actually, it's better to take k over log n, k over log square of n. It's slightly better. But, you know, it's just better not to think about it too much. There is also an issue of the error here all the time, but I'm ignoring it. It just makes the proof harder, but you shouldn't think about it. So, you know, by the name, you can see that, you know, there's another one, because it's the mid in the middle. So, unfortunately, we also need to have it here. So, the left block of V, of, you know, the part of X that corresponds to VMID, we also needed to have a tree structure. Like a block source inside of it. But you know, that's the end of it. So, you know, BRSW needs just two, we need three. I don't know how to do it with two, sorry. And it's even worse because BRSW had Y sitting there, and they used Y to kind of understand the structure of X. To kind of, not exactly, but essentially finding V mid and V top in some sense. Not finding them, but kind of finding enough information about them so to guarantee a dispersal. And we actually need also this extra structure from Y. So we also need to apply Y this lemma three times, from different reasons, by the way. So that you have this U top, so the nodes here will be denoted by V and here by U, just for to make it clear. And then the left son of U top should also have this property. And then the left son of U mid should also have this property. And so it's just a 6 log n deficiency. You do it 3 times, you just get a 6 log n. Every time you do a 2 log n. And it really what's happened is that the entropy reduces to k over log cube of n or something. It already prevents you from constructing Ramsey graph like Erdős wanted, because you need at least log cube of n entropy to do it. But you know, that's what I know how to do. So, okay, so we call these things the entropy paths. Okay, because as Yavishai said, it's a path. So this is the entropy path of x, and this is the entropy path of y. And it would have been great just to find them. If we could find them, I mean, find any of these guys, we would have finished. We just applied the block extractor with that block and y. So we almost do that. So in the fourth step of the algorithm, so now I can write the steps that I wanted to do before. In the fourth step, can you see this? I mean, this is, the angle is right. In the first step, we essentially, following BRSW, we identify the entropy paths. We find them. So, you know, what does it mean to find them, right? So, to be slightly more precise, by finding them, we just, you know, given little x and little y, just compute what we call the observed paths. P observed, this is inside T of x, and Q observed. This is inside T of y, just the path of them, the paths. So these are functions of x and y. So let me just describe P observed. Q observed is the same thing as T of y. So what you output here is, you know, you just output a log. So you just output first the unique rooted binary tree of depth log n. So this is not really an output, just template. And then P observed XY is just a marking of some root to leaf path on that tree. So we just, this is actually the output. Just a sequence of V1 of X1, V2 of X1, until V log N of X1, of XY. And what you want is that, this path will go through these vertices, V top, V mid, and V bottom. It's enough to just require it for V-bottom. So you want this path to go through V-bottom. So what you want, and what we'll prove, is that there exists, so this is the first step. We'll compute this function with this guarantee. There exists some subsources, x prime of x. Right now, x is the tree-structured source that sits inside the relax, but you can forget about the relax. So I forgot about it. So there is an x prime in x, low deficiency. I can't forget about the deficiency. It's something like log square of n or so. And y prime of y, such that with high probability over xy in x prime y prime, p observed xy goes through v bottom. And also Q observed XY goes for U bottom. So again, the first step is just, you know, just compute functions. You're just given little strings, little X and Y strings, and just output things. So given P observed, given X and Y, P observed XY is just a sequence that maybe that's denoted by V1 of XY until V log n of x, y.
Nodes in the tree.
Nodes in, yeah.
Like a direction, like left or right.
Exactly. So it's really just like a log n bits. You know that, you know, V bottom is of depth at most log n. This is what you know. So by identifying the entropy paths, just by the lemma. So by identifying the entropy paths, you don't really want to stop at V bottom. I mean, you really want to, but you can't, I don't know how to do that. So you just say, well, I just compute a path. I mean, it could be the case that V-bottom is the third vertex already, right? So we don't know where it sits, but I know we just compute a path of length of depth log n inside this tree. And we will show that, I wish I could show that, you know, for any x and y in the support of x and y, this path would have contained V-bottom and therefore also V-mid and V-top. But you don't know how to do that. I also don't know how to show that it holds with high probability over x and y. But you do know that, you know, there is a subsource of load efficiency, x prime inside x, and subsource y prime in y, such that with high probability inside of these sources, and you're fine with moving to subsources, you get this guarantee. So pictorially, you know, this is x and y. But you know, obviously, I won't draw 0, 1 to the n on each side. Just 0, 1 to the n is the entire board. It's the easiest. And so it's not true. So p observed of x, y, on each point here, it outputs some path. Different path, maybe. But you know that on some subsources, besides a small error that I'm kind of ignoring for all along, in each point here, the path goes through V bottom. They might go differently below that, which is a real problem for the rest of the analysis. But you know that they have the right behavior from the top, from like the root, sorry, to V bottom. Okay, so this is the first step that we will do. And this is not the sample, the distribution. So there is the underlying distribution of this random variable that dictates the entropy parts. Right. So this is a pre-sampling. This is before you sample. This is how the distribution behaves.
But it's a function of your effects.
No, V bottom
is not a function.
It's a fixed subset of the coordinate.
Okay, but it has to do with the source.
Yeah.
But not with the sample.
Right, just with the source itself.
Every source is
it's like a source has a behavior. Yeah.
It's like if I was just my source was half random bits and half fixed.
It's a subset of the coordinates. It's the source.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
I guess two subsets, one x and one y, and it has nothing to do.
I mean, x has a.
Somehow y helps you sample from y helps you find this.
Yeah. This is the magic of channel response. It looks like unattainable, maybe incorrect,
yeah,
but it.
I mean, if it does random bits and it could do some random
process. I don't know.
Sorry,
but it's not random.
What?
No, I mean, if y was random, then I could.
I mean, but alone, I think I would imagine you can't do that. I mean, just given x, you kind of use the randomness in y. No, it's like I think it's a great idea to.
So you have to wait a little bit too. But this is well defined for every source. It's just
okay,
a subset
yeah.
of the
okay.
Right. Yeah. So for example, you read BRSW. It's written very well. Sorry, Avi. And you read it, and there is a long overview of the proof. And you read it and say, you know, no way the proof can follow this. There are so many lies here, probably. And when you read the proof, it's the same thing with the errors add to it. It's just the same. It's really amazing. Yes. I mean, I was fooled, so I'm fine. But there is some. There is some technical here. So technicality issue here. So BRSW needed to find V top and V mid in some sense. It didn't just the entropy path using Y. It's not that clear that you can do it together. I mean, just if you use Y to find this path, it might create some problems to find this path using X now. But it shouldn't and it doesn't, but you need to work slightly more carefully to do so. I mean, you need to find both paths here. So
can you do it separately?
So you need to see the channel response mechanism to see that there is, to see why. I can point for the moment why it works. But you should do it kind of simultaneously in some sense. We'll see. I wasn't sure it would work at the beginning, but then, okay. So this is the first step, just computing these functions. And from now on, so we can clearly forget about moving to subsources, right? And we can also forget about the error. There is an issue with the error. I mean, it, now that you move to a subsource, you may move to a subsource that sits too much inside the error. But if you are guaranteed that the error is smaller than the deficiency will take again, then you are fine. That the, if you move to deficiency 2, deficiency 1, it just multiply the error. So if deficiency is small compared to the, I mean large, sorry, small, compared to the error, the smallness of the error, then you are fine. So you can kind of ignore that.
So did you say that you cannot prove it for every x and y, but it's not even true for every x and y?
Right. Right. That's true. You have to move to.
What would be the error, more or less, inside the small source that you drew the small rectangle?
You can control it, but you can make it like 2 to the minus k of, to the omega of 1.
2 to the minus?
K to the omega of 1. You can make it as small as you want, up to this polynomial in k. But when you want a small error, you get also smaller subsources, so there is some tension there. But you can, it's really not an issue when you see this.
Why do you need to do it also for y? I mean, wouldn't it be enough just to find the block source in x?
But okay, right. So now you have these things, and you know you need to find one of them. And if I only had y, I don't know how to do it. I need really this structure. You'll see exactly why. But I don't say you have to, but the way the proof goes, I really need this extra structure from y. So this leads to the second step. So in the second step, this is where we deviate from BRSW. We just find VMID with a big asterisk. That I'll talk about. Find VMID. So finding VMID is just some constant thing. It's independent of the samples, just of the distributions. So if you find it, if you know how to find it, then so in one sense finding it, maybe just meet me. So by finding it, I mean we compute this function V observed mid of x and y. And it has this guarantee that, so we compute this function. And the guarantee is that there exists some subsources, x double prime of x prime, just of the previous ones. Here the deficiency is very large, unfortunately. And y double prime of y prime, such that with high probability over x, y, in these subsources, V observed mid, I mean, on top of the path to be the right paths, you also have that the observed V mid is actually V mid. OK, so now what you do is compute this function. And the guarantee is that if you don't mind restricting further to subsources inside the x prime and y prime and adding some error, then you actually this value is V mid. With the asterisks.
And how, what about the deficiency here?
Yeah, it's very large. It leaves you, so far it was k minus little of k, now it will be, you will be left with something that is little of k, but still large. You can, I will say exactly, I mean, yeah. You will be left with something like k over log cube of n. This is what you will be left with. Yeah, so this kind of prevents you from getting an extract. This is the part that is problematic for to get extractors, really. But this is kind of. Okay, so if this were true, if you kind of ignore the asterisks, it is true, but absolute problem, then this first step is kind of obvious. We just output x, v observed mid. Right, so I'm working on the strings, right, when I say output. X and y.
So you really wanted the top, but you can't find it? So
yeah, right. I can't find it. I kind of use v bottom to find v mid. Something happens to v mid in this process. I would say why, what, but.
V bottom of the other guy.
Exactly, exactly.
So bottom of y to find v mid of x.
But you know what? This would have been great. I mean, because Okay, so this looks like a function of x and y, but it's really just constant unless ignoring some error. So it's really great that this is a block source and this is a weak source and you output the right thing. There are no dependencies. So this is the right pattern. Unfortunately, I mean, it's kind of ironic that the only way we know how to find V mid.
So the output here is B E.
Yeah. Sorry. Can I do it this way? Sorry. So, unfortunately, kind of ironically, the only way we know how to find vmid is to kill the left part of vmid. So, they only know how to analyze and prove that v observed mid of xy equals vmid by, I mean, one of the steps would be to kind of, we need to fix x double prime, you know, forget about this, of the left sun of V mid, of the real V mid. So, you know, the only way we know how to find the block source is to kill its left block. And now it's not a block source anymore, which is really ironic. You want to find it, you kill it, and then you see it. So, initially, I did these hula hoops with things. So I used quantum arguments. I just did some hula hoops. But then I just accord that you can just, you know, if you append x here, then you're fine. So what do I mean here? I mean, so now this is a block source. It kind of bothers you whether the block source sits in the middle or not. So this is the only example where it doesn't sit in the middle. So take this as a block source. Just append zeros to it to make it of length n, if you want. And I claim that, you know, even if you fix this left block of xv mid, then this is still a block source because of vtop essentially. I would say why, but this is why we needed the third level or the fourth level. And so why is this true? So
the claim is that
if you can do step two, even in the expense or even in the cost of fixing the left block of the block source that you try to find, xv mid. So this is kind of the left block, because the left sun. Then even if this is the only way we know how to do it, so this won't work. This won't be uniform, but this will. So if you just append x to it. Concatenate x. Yeah.
Even if there are repetitions, you don't care. I mean, it's not, you will have entropy on the left because you had entropy on the right side of the and you will have entropy
It's no, x concatenate is not a block source because when you fix x, x is fixed.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, you need to leave some entropy.
Okay.
So, yeah. So
you bring back to life the
x itself
that you killed. You don't know where it is.
Right.
Somewhere in x.
You don't bring to life where to kill. You bring back to life the guy from V top, not from V mid. What you fix in the V mid, you fix.
Oh, also in x. Okay.
Yeah. And the reason this is a block source, to show that this is a block source, you need to show that this is entropy and condition on any fixing of this is entropy.
This is the reason you need mid and top, and you need the bottom to find the mid.
Yeah, the bottom is for the difference, is for step one. Yeah, so there actually is no dependency if you ignore the error. So you know that this thing with high probability is just the V mid itself, like the right block. So ignoring this little error, this is just fixed. Right, so you can always they are close to being in
there. There might be more.
Yeah, but there is only one V mid because you define it in a. We define it only in a deterministic way. It's essentially the leftmost block that is a block source. Right. So essentially, in general, extractor works also for random variables that are close to being independent. Because you can always take out the independent random variable and just add the epsilon to the error. So it's the same thing. So if, yeah. And vmid was defined
and it's not clear that this tree structure is unique, but however you...
It is unique. It's completely unique.
It is unique.
Yeah.
You know the entropy of every subinterval.
Yeah.
So. I mean, but you have a choice. You can either go...
No.
You take the first one.
You choose it arbitrarily. Yeah.
Okay. But.
No, there are many blocks in which... But the way it was defined is completely unique. Right, I should have said that you right, you prefer 2 over 3 and 1
but
over 2.
I want to say that even if it's not unique, then you're okay, because
right.
I assume that you have a...
Right, I know.
Then it takes the subsource. Then the subsource is true, because everything is fixed. I don't block
the block. There's no reason to go into this argument. You're fixed. It doesn't matter if it would have been okay if it was not fixed. No, because yes,
Okay.
What you have to make sure is that the limit stays the same when you move
right.
all these subsources.
Right.
Especially when you do this bit here.
Yeah.
It's a V-mid also of the...
Yeah. It's just V-mid, and when you fix it's left.
That's right. But in most of the cases, you lose very little deficiency.
Okay.
Right.
When you kill almost all the entropy.
Right. Right. So the way x double prime is choosing x prime is certainly preserved V-mid. It relates to it. So can I just explain why the asterisk is still fine? Namely, why even if you fix the left block of V-mid, it's still okay to. I mean, this is still a block source. Okay. So the reason is that it's kind of simple, but. So let me just say, initially I thought we can overcome this by taking a not a binary, but a trinary tree.
Ternary.
Wow.
Ternary children.
Yeah, okay. Okay. So you take a ternary, yeah. And if you fix the left block, you can kind of mimic things and fix the left block, and then you will be stayed with 2 blocks, which is great. And then you can apply the Lie only on these 2 guys. But if you move to 3, if you consider everything here but with 3 with 3 sons, then you can't guarantee that entropy is close to k. It might be k over 2. Or, I mean, it could be the case. Just 2 is the right number to make sure that either it's a block source or that one of them has all the entropy. Otherwise, you don't have it. So this is kind of mimicking 3 ternary trees with 2, in the sense that what do we have? We have is a kind of have all of x, and inside of it, it really doesn't look like that, but inside of it, you have v-top, right? V-top should sit somewhere here, but you have v-top. And in the left part of v-top, you have v-mid. Right? Somewhere in the left part of v-top, you have v-mid, which is also split into 2. And what happened is that you fix this guy. So, you know, notice that, first of all, this does have this, so this part has entropy because you just fix its left part. It was a block source, it has entropy. Why x has entropy even condition on this guy? So before the fixing, even x v top had entropy condition on this guy. And x v top is just part of it. You don't know where it is, so you just do all of x, but it's just a part of it. Now, when you fix v mid, all you do is just restrict the allowed fixes. Right?
So now the block source is not split in the middle.
Right. You don't care. You can just append zeros because algorithmically you can make it split in the middle. Right. This is the best way to kind of avoid it. You just add the zeros. And it doesn't introduce dependencies and etc. So right. So because the fixing the left part of vmid keeps x vmid with entropy, and because it still holds that for any fixing of this guy x vtop has entropy because now we just less fixes allowed, but you don't care about that. When this is a block source, yet still. Okay. So this is the program. The program will be in step 1 to follow BRSW and just identify the entropy paths in this sense while moving to low deficiency subsource and ignoring error. And in the second step, that kind of deviates from the original paper, we'll find vmid in this sense. But we'll do it in the price of fixing the left part of vmid. And nevertheless, we can kind of handle this situation as well by outputting this thing. Okay, so that's the general plan. And Yeah, so I think we have done 50 minutes. Maybe we'll take a break and continue afterwards, or?
It's up to you, but okay.
Yeah. So let's take 10 minutes break and we talk. Okay, thank you. Okay, so this was the general plan and the kind of engine, the mechanism, they call it, it's a good name. Behind this is the kind of a challenge response mechanism. So this is introduced in BKS as W, and then in BRS W it was refined a bit. And generally speaking, very generally, very broadly speaking, this is a mechanism that allows you to distinguish between two cases. You're given a random variable, you want to figure out whether it has low entropy or high entropy. This is what the ideal mechanism would do. Just figure out not the amount of entropy, but whether it's above some threshold or below some threshold. So you won't be able to do that. I mean, I don't know if you won't, but this doesn't do that. So what you will be able is to kind of distinguish the extreme cases between whether the random variable has a lot of entropy and whether it's fixed, has zero entropy. It will be enough for us. And more precisely, what you will have, you always have these two random variables in the background, x and y, these ambient random variables, two sources. And someone will give you a function of them, deterministic function of them. And what you want is to figure out whether this function is fixed or whether it has high entropy. This kind of general thing I will write now. And this kind of a dream version that I will make more formal in a second. So here is kind of a dream version of the chance response mechanism. So really, this is just a function response. There is a challenge and a response. So it gets two samples with two-bit strings, but we think of them as two samples, and a third sample from a function on these two, you will see in a second, that you want to figure out how much entropy it has in it, or whether, more precisely, whether it's fixed or has high entropy. So the output is just either fixed, it just declares fixed, or it declares has entropy. Okay, so this is the output of the chance response mechanism. And the guarantee is the following. So it's kind of actually a theorem, not a definition. So the guarantee is the following. For any poly log n sources, for some fixed poly that BRSW constructed, for any poly log n independent sources, x and y, right, we have these two ambient random variables. These are the two sources. It's not exactly the two sources. We will use parts of the sources, etc., but this is essentially the two sources. And for any function, deterministic function, a challenge that is applied on the samples and it outputs some bits, you have the following. So the first case is that if you look at the challenge, on x and y, if this thing is fixed, this is the function that you try to figure out. This is a random variable, right? It's a function of random variables. You want to figure out whether it's fixed or not. So if it is fixed, then let me write it this way. The probability that when you sample x from x and y from y, the probability that the response actually tells you fixed. So the response when you feed to x, little y, and this function applied to little x, little y, the probability that this is fixed is 1. Right? It always says fixed. It's not what will happen really, but this is kind of a dream version. So you know, the first case is where this has a very low entropy, fixed in this case. This.
How many bits are there? Challenge function? What is its location? It's all?
It's a small number of bits.
Yeah. Right, so L, so the larger L is, the kind of the more you will pay. You move to low deficiency subsources, etc.
So you should think about it as
Polylog n, yeah. Right. We'll take it log n or log square of n all the time. Okay, so if the random variable is fixed, so if this function applied to x and y is fixed, then the mechanism was fixed. And the second case is that if, let me just leave some this thing, if the challenge of xy has entropy k, okay, it's not like the same k, like k prime, some entropy that you know of. It's like for any k prime. If the, this has entropy k prime, then it will say, you know, has entropy. When the probability of x on x and y sampled from y, that the response mechanism tells you, has entropy is 1. Okay, so this would be an amazing thing. Yeah, of course, yeah. This would be an amazing, it's a dream version.
But it only sees one input.
Right. Yeah, so something is wrong. Yeah, but nevertheless, you know.
But also you didn't say, so the if is waiting for something.
Yeah, so here I'm hiding things and even here I'm lying. But, you know, this is dream version. If, and you can kind of forget about it in the dream version, if it doesn't be k prime and this holds, I mean, regardless of k prime, I mean, it's kind of, but anyhow, this is the general idea. And you have to have some fixes to it in each of them. So the first fix here is that, you know, if the challenge is fixed, then what will really happen is that there exists some low deficiency, x prime, which is like 2L or something, and y prime, let me just say L, OK? And y prime, which is y, such that this holds with probability 1. So if it, if the challenge is fixed, the response mechanism won't distinguish that on all of xy. It won't even distinguish that with high probability over xy. Right? But it will distinguish that. So if this is x and y, right, on any point here, it will say either fixed or has entropy. Maybe for in most cases, it will say has entropy. I don't know. What BRSW proved is that there is some low deficiency subsources, depending on L, the number of bits that you test, which makes a lot of sense, on which with probability 1, you say fix. OK, so the response mechanism identifies that this random variable is fixed with probability 1, but on subsources.
So what is L here?
So this is the it's actually order of L, and this is the length of the channel. Yeah, right. It can be really L, but you know it's like, just to be. This kind of makes sense. You need, I mean, for different fixes, you need to, you need L there, right? And this is great. It doesn't introduce you error. It just say that, you know, if you want to apply this mechanism, you must be comfortable with moving to subsources. And we are. And then you can imagine that we are here, that the samples are coming from here. And interestingly, the definition of x prime, the distribution, depends on the distribution of x and the distribution of y. So it's kind of cool. Unlike when you move to the subtrees, where it was just one of them. OK, so this is great. I mean, and the second case is, you know, it's not enough that this random variable would have entropy. It really has to have kind of a robust entropy. What do I mean robust entropy? I mean that, you know, this function, it's not enough that applied to a sample from x and a sample from y, which will have entropy. We require that this holds for any low deficiency subsources. So if for any x hat, deficiency L in x, and y hat, deficiency L in y, if this has entropy, large entropy, so even if you restrict it, you test it kind of on any not too small rectangle inside, if this has entropy, then actually on the original sources, it will say the right answer, but you will lose some expression. Oopsie. Some expression that you can kind of ignore, but I'm just writing it because n should somehow go into the picture, so it enters here. And but you kind of can ignore it, but this is what you get. So again, if the entropy of this random this function, if the random variable of the function applied to any subsource has entropy, if it's not like fixed on one of them, then it will be noticed by the response mechanism. It will say, has entropy on the entire source, but we'll add some error to it. Okay.
And we don't care what happens in other cases.
Right.
These two cases are not exclusive.
Right, right. I mean, there are many in between that. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Okay, so you know, let me just. No, it's not, it's completely non-trivial, but it's a, but I mean, if I had half more hour, maybe I could, but it's just something that we use. It's, now you can, I think, improve it to like, to have more guarantees that I don't know how to use, unfortunately, and the polylogarithmic can be even order of log and stuff like that. But it's an amazing, I think that the definition is amazing. And the fact that you can prove it is also amazing, but the definition is kind of weird that you can do it and use it. So use it. This is to identify. So BRSW and BKSSW used it. Okay, BRSW used it to identify the entropy paths, and I will say exactly how, because I need the precise way they did it for the other part, for the second part. And then I will show you how we use it in a different way, kind of with a different challenge, to find VMID. Right, it works for any challenge. You need to think what challenge you want to.
Just a second. If you don't go to a sub source, this is impossible?
I would think so.
I think so, yeah.
Yeah. I never tried to prove it. But.
What I see is here, you get one sample, one X and Y and one response, one challenge, and you need to decide whether it's fixed all the time?
Yeah, so for different fixes, you can't expect not to move to subsets and for different fixes to still have the right answer. Because for different fixes, when I say challenge XY is fixed, I mean there is some value. And the subsource must depend on the value. And so I never tried to prove it because it didn't need it. But it depends. I think that you should be able to show that you have to move to subsources according
to. These subsources actually fix the function.
Exactly.
Just in case it wasn't really fixed, it fixes it.
The response just needs. So suppose that the answer should be zero in the subset space.
Yeah.
So it just checks the zeros.
Well, yeah, but you have only X and Y, right? So it's what you argue separately. You need to say that you are given X and Y. You want to argue about this whole rectangle X prime Y, and you have to consider. By the way, you didn't say, but when this theorem is not clear how to choose, what is the challenge function?
Yeah, yeah.
The whole thing is you have to.
It's a mechanism. It's a.
It's not. You have to. In order to pick it, you have to look at parts of the sources, and you have this parts have to select. But anyway, in order to guarantee that in part one the answer is correct, what you do is move to subsources in which it is correct.
Okay.
Yeah.
And that's why you pay this. Only you have to do it in the case
right.
It was no entropy, otherwise you waste the chance of catching entropy. It cannot be. Just doing part one period is the problem.
Just
yeah.
Go to a place where it's just fixed.
Yeah, but you want to do it only if it looks like low entropy, because otherwise, you are looking for entropy, it's there. You have to find it.
Okay, so now it's
Okay. Good.
The response mechanism is efficient, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Although the challenge would be anything.
Right. Right. I mean, we will generate the challenges, so it will be efficient, but right, it works for any challenge. For the analysis sake, you can do that. Okay, so how could we? Okay, so let's consider step one now. I'll do it a bit briefly because I don't want to go. I mean, we will go on to all the details, but let me just not write everything in this step. So in this step, let's consider just a t of x. Right. So what we want to do is to output this path. We call it p observed x y. And we want it, restricted to some subsources, having some error, we want it to go through a V bottom. And we want the same thing for Q observing, T of Y, but forget about that. So the way we will kind of draw this path, this is what we kind of want. We're happy with that. So the way we'll draw this path is as follows. So starting from the leaves upwards, every parent, so you have some parent, he will try to decide which of its two kids is good, which of its two sons is good. So what does it mean to be a good son? So it doesn't make much sense most of the time, but if you have a node that sits above V-bottom, right in the root, it's an ancestor of V-bottom, then its good son is its unique son that also is above V-bottom, or V-bottom itself. Right, so the good son of this guy is this guy, etc., and this has no good son. Okay. Also, V-bottom doesn't have any good son. So what we will try to do is we devise some algorithm that enables a parent to decide, in case it has a good son, which of them it is. And so we choose that. So it kind of marks this arrow. And if you do it upwards, then when you get to the root and you look at the path that you have, if everything went well, you will go for V-bottom. Right, just by definition, because he would choose it good son, etc. So we just need to find a mechanism that enables someone to, in case that it is indeed an ancestor of V-bottom, to decide which of its sons is good sons, is good son. So let's start by trying to see how V-bottom's parent, even though he doesn't know it's V-bottom's parent, identifies V-bottom among the two. Okay, and this will kind of we'll then do the general case. So say I'm here, V, and V bottom sits either here or here. The way we'll do this, the way we'll kind of V will decide which of its two sons is good is he will just talk to his left son in some sense. And if the left son doesn't convince him in some sense, then it will choose the right son. So the conversation is always to the left, which is kind of important. So here is the conversation. So
just like Isaac with
what was it? Okay, so say V-bottom is on the left. Let's see how we can convince this father, its parent, that it's his good son. And then we'll show that if it happened to be on the right, the other son won't convince him. Okay, and that's enough. So what V-bottom will, so the way V will choose, so V will declare. So now V knows that it's the parent of V-bottom, just for this algorithm, okay? It just doesn't know which of the sons is V-bottom. So V will declare its left son is V-bottom if and only if he will take the challenge response mechanism, of course. So the first ambient source is itself.
Now we show that we know the
question. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Right, and then we'll remove that assumption. Right, so here V knows that one of them is. So we'll just, it will use the channel response mechanism with, not with all of X, but with XV, his part. It's crucial, and Y. And, sorry, and the challenge will be, okay. So what V will do is he will apply the challenge response mechanism with itself, like with XV as the source of randomness, the first one, Y as the second one. And the challenge is essentially he will go to his left son and will say, no, compute the block store extractors on yourself in Y. And if the response mechanism will say has entropy, I will believe you that you are V bottom. Otherwise, the other one is. Okay.
That's why you need Li for many bits and you
right. Exactly. Exactly. Right. Exactly for this. I need these two for this reason.
So you need to prove that you have entropy, and the way of proving it is showing that you can base an extractor on yourself.
I need to figure out which of my sons is the block source. So it kind of makes sense to try applying a block extractor. It's kind of weird. Usually, when you construct extractors before BKSSW, I think that every time people just applied the extractor and then used that computation as part of the input, but not as a branching. So here it's kind of a branching. If the extractor outputs something which I'm happy with, I won't ever output it. I'll just do something. It's kind of branch. Like
this is
yeah, just you. Determining, exactly. Kind of weird.
You are gonna.
Yeah, exactly. I think it's the 4 DKSW is the first time you saw this one. I think this is kind of, if you think of it, I think this is kind of the coolest idea.
So what's the length that you're taking of the block extractor? What's
right. The output length? So you can call it, it would be, so if you want fixed, so there is no error for this person. So it's kind of a, it would be roughly log n, but polylog n is something that it's less than the entropy. Okay. So why this work? So we need to consider two cases. The first case is where indeed the left hand is the bottom, and this looks great because you know this is a block source in the, because this is x v bottom, and this is a weak source independent of that. And not only that, even if you move to low deficiency subsources, the block source remain a block source and the weak source remain a weak source. And you need that, right? You need to be able to, you need the challenge not to be random or have entropy on the sources, but on any low deficiency subsources. But it still holds because of the facts that we wrote before. So indeed, this thing, again, up to some error in determining the right output, et cetera, is uniform, and certainly it has entropy. Close to uniform, and certainly it's close to have entropy. This is enough for us. And so in that case, the response mechanism with high probability on the original sources will say yes, it has entropy, and therefore the decision is correct. Now, in the second case, V is the father of V bottom, but you know the other son is here, and the communication is with this son. But in this case, recall that this thing is fixed. I mean, just by the way you define the tree structure, the only way we moved here is because this was fixed. So now, this guy, which is exactly the part of x that corresponds to the left hand of V bottom, is just some fixed value.
And
yeah, in the tree that we are working in this.
Before you take the subsource.
Yeah. Avi want to say that this is fixed now in the subsource. Right. So since this is fixed, then the challenge is actually a function only of y. Right, and it's only of a few bits. I mean, log n, polylog n bits.
Just by pigeonhole.
Exactly. So there is a fixing of it that doesn't. So if this is x and this is y, then since this is fixed, there is some fixing. In fact, yeah, most fixing. But there is some fixing of this function that leaves you in a. So this is kind of y that leaves you in a smaller, but not too smaller, y prime. It's a deficiency of the length. So once this is fixed here, the challenge response mechanism guarantees that you know somewhere inside this rectangle, you have something that the response mechanism always say fixed. And so you move to that subsource. Okay. Oh, I need this picture somewhere. So this is great. And let me tell you. I don't need to find. Just for the analysis. No. It's just for the analysis. I mean, it's true that you move in the analysis to this subsource, but you never have to. Yeah, it also never have a small representation, maybe. It could be.
Okay, but this is the algorithm itself. You need to know where to go, right?
Right. So these are strings.
Whether it says half entropy, has entropy or fixed, you know whether mm-hmm. to go left or right.
So you need to use one there, and one says that there exists
a one part. Yeah, but it will not. Yeah, so there will exist for the analysis.
You
never care.
For the analysis, you know that they exist, and there are low deficiency. And what you will do is, if it's fixed, you will go up.
This is what I was talking
so
about.
So with some probability you will land in x prime y.
No, this that's only the probability inside.
I always review something little x and little y.
The probability that you apply only on your sample, but the probability rows there is over x prime and y prime.
So if you do it over x and y, the probability.
You don't care. You now imagine that you are in x prime times y prime, and you know that.
No,
not in the first
one.
Always
no,
on
yeah, right,
yeah,
for the first
one. Yeah. And only what he claims that there exists X prime.
So it
No. No, just
no.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Maybe I should have said that, yeah, but it just happened to be the case that you write what you want. So actually, it is very important for. I couldn't have done it if I needed to be one in order to find both of them, but you can't see it here. Okay. So. Okay. So how can? Okay. So that was a kind of a toy example. Yeah, sorry.
So x left sum v, it's not really fixed, right? So in your lemma, it's like for every fixing of the left, the right has a large.
Yeah, so you can assume it's fixed to any value that you want. And it still will have high entropy.
So if you take a sample, it may not actually give you a fixed from x.
Again, sorry? If you No, no, it's fixed. Yeah, so you move to a subsource of the original x in which this is fixed. I agree that you can fix it to, the claim is stronger for any fixing of this part, this entropy, but you just declare one of them. If you want to construct extractor, you care about that. But if not, then you don't. Yeah, it's kind of an overkill because you fix it anyhow. Yeah. But I'll just continue on because if that's okay. So now how, so this was kind of unfair because, we assumed V-bottom is one of its sons. You can always assume, assume one of its sons, and it used that fact because he applied a block extractor, right? So how did BRSW manage to get it more generally? So note that here we're actually giving the response mechanism something much stronger than he needs. We give him a uniform string in case it's a block source. We only have to give him something with entropy, which is much lesser. So the way BRSW said, and you should be careful when you do that, is they said, well, let's say this is V and this is U, the V from before, the parent of V bottom. Let's say it sits here. And now V wants to convince its parent, I don't know where it sits really, but he wants to convince its parent that I'm a good son, my son or some descendant of mine is V bottom. So he can't just give to him block extractor with this value because it may not work. But he can just concatenate the block extractor of this value with the block extractor of this value. Right? So this is V and V bottom from before. And now I want to kind of see how you can convince you, the parent of V, that V is its good son in the sense that it's a parent or an ancestor of V bottom. So the way to do so is just, because you're allowed to only have entropy, you don't have to be uniform. You can just, so you will decide, and in general, so in more generally, we will have the following challenge. So I call it the good son challenge. I don't know. Right, so the good son challenge of x in general, I just write something of xv for any v. Yeah, so in the paper I call it the preferred son, and Meshi was born at the same time. So I should change it for. Maybe the preferred daughter, or, I don't know. So the good son challenge of x, v, and y, instead of being just the block extractor of x, v, and y, is a kind of a matrix of def at most log n, say def log n. And so at the depth of v, at the row, which is the depth of v, we just write the block extractor, like we did before, with x, v, and y. So this is in case I am V bottom. So this will be uniform. Otherwise, and you should be a bit careful here, you take the block extractor of x, V prime, and y, where V prime, I agree, it depends on x and y. So it's kind of, should be careful. But it's the kind of observed good son, the thing that you think is your preferred son, which hopefully is a good son. And here you put some zeros. You don't know what's going on. V prime is the good son of V according to this test. Not necessarily really the good son, but with high probability it will be the good son.
It's a recursive.
Yeah, it's a recursive. Yeah, BRSW prefers to see it as a recursive argument. I just opened the recursive because right, so in this case, so if V itself is V bottom and it tries to convince its parent, okay, sorry, so what the parent will do? So now you have a V, a different V. This is for any V you define this thing. No, but let me write the response, because otherwise V could be two things. So for general V, I'm defining this. And for general V, V decides, maybe it's a bad name, right? But decides that its left sum is its good sum, kind of declare, if and only if the response of XV Y good sum challenge of X of left sum of V and Y says has entropy. So here's how it works. You have a V and it talks to its left sum in this respect. And its left sum give this matrix with V being left sum of this V as a challenge. Now, if V is an ancestor, if left sum of V is an ancestor of the V bottom, then some row here, you should be a bit careful, but some row here would be uniform or close to uniform. And so the whole challenge has entropy. And so V will be convinced that its left sum is an ancestor of a good sum. The choices, right. So you should be careful. Right. So with low probability.
If V is just the parent of V.
Yes, actually, exactly. Just think of grandparents. Just think of a grandparent.
Right.
Just think that U is a parent of V, and V is a parent of V bottom. It doesn't know which one. It doesn't know whether it's left or right. So for V, we know already that V will determine correctly after all this subsequent. Whether left or right, but he was now convinced his father,
you,
he is the father of
people. But it's not a one shot thing.
It is a one shot, it's all in parallel.
Right.
It's
you can.
But you need to run the response many times.
No, because you list all the, you know, everybody lists the possibilities below the, below. You can run all this, these are just functions, you can compute them.
No, I mean, V prime is a function. I mean, it's true, I think, that the things that, I mean, with small probability, these are not constant. I mean, you won't have the right things.
But
you,
right,
exactly. It's the same, you just follow the paths. With high probability, so below V bottom, I don't know what's going on. But above it, with high probability, you will have the right nodes. Yeah, exactly. It's really important to have this. You always talk just to the left sum. It's independent of the sample. Okay.
No, okay, but then
so think of it. Say you know that V believed to V bottom in the sentence, you know, he put an error there. So now, at some point in the challenge that V will pass to you, appears block extractor with high probability. But you forget about the low probability.
There is a proof.
Yeah, exactly.
But you never go right, so.
No, I can go if I don't believe it. If.
But you don't know that you don't believe it because you run everything in parallel.
No, the analysis tells you that you believe the right sum all the time, besides small probability. Just, you know, you do it inductively upwards. I mean, the proof is inductively upwards, but the.
Now remember that if the left sun is fixed and the right side, the right sun is
a good sun.
Is a good sun. This is the
right.
Entropy tree
structure.
How do you know which one is V prime in that? How do you construct this tree where you don't know which one is V prime before you run this test?
No, you do it from leaves to top, right? So once you need to figure out the situation, so once you need to figure out who is his good son, V already knows who is his good son.
Okay, so it's not one shot.
Not really, it's like in layers.
Yeah, but.
Okay, it's but it's not one shot. You're not doing it.
With high probability, you know what will happen. Right? Oh, obviously, that with high probability, I mean, you know who will be V prime. Just because it's. Okay, yeah, so it's not, I mean, I don't mind either way, but it's...
You can think of it as a sequential, but
right, exactly. Okay, so now let's assume we found P observed and Q observed this way, right? Because we know how to find them. And now let's find V mid. And I guess this is kind of the main technical contribution here, So here's the thing. So we will design a new challenge. We also use the challenge response mechanism because it's so great. But we will use a new challenge to do it. We need a different task, a different challenge. So we call it the node path challenge, as opposed to the good challenge. So it goes like this. So you take a vertex. This is kind of a general description. So you take a vertex v in t of x, and you take a root to leaf path in t of y. Okay? Okay, so you have some, of course, this q will be q observed at the end, but you take some path in t of y from root to leaf, and you say take some, you have t of x here, you take some vertex here. It's not clear who would that be. And what you do is you define the node path challenge of x v, this kind of just saying that you really just look about the v part of x, okay? And yq, just looking at the q part of x, of y, is again a log n, a matrix of log n rows. I thought about it for a while, but it's so unrelated, so I can. All right. So the ith row here, I don't have some room, so I just take it here. The ith row contains a block extractor applied to use again this extractor, but in a different way. Ywi and xv. Wi is the ith vertex on the path. So again, you take a node in t of x and a root to leaf path in t of y. And you define a challenge with respect to this node and path, where the challenge is composed of log n rows. Each row applies least block extractor with the same weak source. Notice now the weak source kind of flipped before x was kind of with the same weak source, xv all the time. And the block source, you kind of try to guess who is the block source. So you go over all block sources, all vertices on this path. And so this is just the definition, and v observed mid. So this is what we want to prove v mid is with high probability and some low deficiency subsources. V observed mid is the, just let me write the definition, is the largest I in 1, 2 till log n, such that okay, response x, y, node path challenge of x, vi, x, and y, q observed x and y has entropy. Let me kind of compile this, but decide this for. So we want an algorithm that, given little x and little y, find vmid, right? In the sense that we want to compute this value that with high probability in low deficiency subsources equal vmid. So the way we'll do so is we have a picture there, so maybe is the following. So p observed, right, is just a path of length log n. It looks like that. And you know that up, or you know,
we don't
up.
Look at P observed, we look at Q observed.
No, I mean, sorry. It's the largest, yeah, no, but. Okay, so V1 till V log n.
Choosing
V. Right. I should have maybe emphasized, but I will just say it now. So here, the algorithm essentially will do the following, even before the challenge. He has this P observed path, and he knows, you know, that up, V bottom and above are fine, and here you have some random variable depend on x and y still, what's going on here. And what he wants is to find V mid. And The way we will do it, so is we will design a test, this test, based on the chance loss mechanism. And the test will have two properties, or let's say it's one property. And the property is that the test will fail on all nodes here, and it will pass on vmid. And above, I don't know what's going on. So once you have such a test, you can just algorithmically go on p-observed from bottom to top until you find a vertex that you know the test succeeds on him, that passed the test. And the test will, so any node here will try, so the test will, so the nodes here will try to pass the test, so, or more precisely, the test uses this q-observed as well, which may introduce lots of correlation. You should be very careful, but it uses q-observed as well. So how does it work? How does the test works? So first of all, you see that we indeed going, so the so v-observed mid is defined to be the deepest vi, right? Vi is just the ith vertex on p-observed. The deepest vi that passed this test. And what the test is, you just apply the response mechanism with all of x and all of y using this challenge. And the challenge, have a lot of x and y's. So you apply it with x with this vertex and y with the entire path on t of y. And the claim that will, so in order to show that this thing is. Right. It's not to say that you just look at some small part of y. You look at all of y, even right, even in u1, because it's the root. It's just everything. But it's just a notation. I'm not sure it's helpful. No, just a notation saying that maybe I should put it like in a sub something here. But I just do it this way. Right. According to this path, which unfortunately is also a function of x and y. So the node path challenge is defined like give me any path and any node and path. Then you have this challenge. So this is this matrix with the block extractors applied. But the path that we will take is actually this q-observed. And the node that we will try it on are the lowest one in p-observed upwards. And the proposition that maybe we need some more. And the proposition, I don't know where exactly to use a proposition and a lemma, but it feels like a proposition. So we don't use it many times. So what you show is that there exist some subsources. I don't know. Let's say that, okay, so we had p-observed and q-observed, and we know that you identify them with high probability on subsources. Let's call them x and y, these subsources. You can forget about the original ones. So there exist some subsources, x prime in x. And again, x is where the subsource in which step one succeeded. And y prime in y, such that with high probability over x, y, in x prime, y prime, two things happened. For any I that's kind of below, it's larger than the depth of v mid, below v mid, this thing, response of x, y, node path challenge, okay, with y, same thing, is fixed. And secondly, the response with x, y, node path challenge, x, v mid, let me just write the whole thing, y q observed, okay, so this proposition tells you what you want. It tells you that, you know, if you move to low deficiency subsources, then with high probability there, every node below vmid, the depth is larger, if you apply this test, it will say fixed. And on vmid, it will say has entropy. It's the same test. I'm just writing the right VI here. So it's like V, this is the VI, which is V mid. And so this guarantee, if this is true, it's guaranteed that V observed mid is the right answer, is V mid on some load efficiency subsources with high probability. Right. Exactly. Too bad. Okay, so I have like 5 minutes. Yeah. I need 10. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Okay. So I tried to do it, but. Okay. Okay, so you want to prove two things. So even before you start, let me just fix what I promised that we will do. We'll fix the left son of vmid, and like the random variable corresponding to that node, and the left son of umid. So let's define x alpha. So alpha is some string to be x conditioned on x, where the left son of V mid is just alpha. Okay, so we look at this random variable. So this is a much low, it's a very low deficiency subsource. Right? You may left with not that much. And Y beta is the same thing as Y, condition on Y, where the left son of U mid is beta. Okay? So because there is some small error, you can't really choose any alpha and beta here, but you can essentially, by averaging, almost any alpha and beta would work. So just fix alpha and beta any way you want. I just need them to be fixed. And I just need it not to be fixed inside the error, but it's not really an issue. Okay, so now this is x alpha and y beta. And now, what do we want to prove in point one? In point one, we want to prove that if this vi is below v mid, when this says fixed, right? We want nodes below VMID to not pass the test, to fail the test. We want this to say fixed. Now the child response mechanism says fixed if this is fixed. So we need to make sure that there are low deficiency subsources or deficient some subsources of x alpha and y beta on which this thing is fixed. It doesn't look like it will happen because you have like three x's and three y's here. They're interleaved together. And you can't just fix it because it will introduce dependencies between x and y. You need to make sure that you do it carefully. So let's see how we can find low deficiency subsources on which this thing is fixed. None of them is fixed. So Q observed x, y, and V of x, y depends on x and y. Because, right, so these are the entropy, these are the observed entropy paths. I agree that from here to here, it's all is fixed. It's actually fixed to the right value. But here, these are still functions of x and y.
So it's not a constant.
It's not constant. Right. And also in Q observed.
Above.
Right, exactly. Yeah. But you need to worry about, in p-observed, you need to worry about things below v-mid, so we know some of them are fixed, but the others are not.
Can you think we're thinking as if we fix those two things?
No, I want, yeah, so the goal, okay, so this is a very...
How to fix it.
Yeah.
I want to fix it. You promise that he will say, he will not pick any node below v-mid. He wants to identify v-mid. So he has to arrange it somehow that this value, despite the entropy, that can be only done by going to subsources,
right.
But the question is how to do it without the dependence.
Right.
You want it to really be a rectangle.
Right, exactly. You want to keep the shape, the independence. So you need to make sure that this is fixed for any I which is larger than the depth of we mid. Because you want above it I don't mind what's going on there.
So what's the problem?
The problem is that it doesn't seem like a very fixed thing. I mean, if it was just a function of x or a function of y, we could have handled, we just fix it to some good value. But it's a function of both x and y, and each of them appears three times. So it's not clear that you can kind of get rid of the dependencies. And then, yeah, so we need to fix it in a kind of an alternating way. And so let's first start with this thing. Let's first fix this thing. And by fixing, I mean, let's move to low deficiency subsources on which this thing is fixed, and you know these subsources are independent still. And so once we do this, you know, they're all most of it is the same anyhow. So Q observed XY. And this is the path. This is the path that you apply the null path challenge to. And most of it, or you know, I don't know if most, but some of it is fixed, right? Up until this part. And so it's not only fixed, it's actually fixed to what we want, but it's fixed. So we just need to make sure that these will be fixed as well. And let's just do one. Let's do the sun of U bottom. Let's do the fixing iteratively. Okay, so how does U bottom choose who is its good sun? Let's just recall that. So recall that U bottom declares its left sun as its good sun if and only if, so we applied BRSW, if and only if there was the response mechanism applied with with y, it's kind of reversed because it's with y and the u bottom, right? So u bottom only used his entropy, all of x, and then used the good sun challenge with y of the left sun, u bottom. Maybe it's written somewhere here. I don't know. Ah, for x. Okay, so of a u bottom and all of x. And you know, it says if and only if it has entropy. So essentially, anyhow, the decision was based on whether on this value. Now, since we fixed the left sun of u mid, and u bottom is a descendant of it, might be left sun or what, then you know that this thing is fixed, right? Because it's just y of some constant string. And certainly this one is, because it's just the left part of that fixed string, that fixed string. So the decision really is just a function of x. The decision of who is your sun is a function of x. It's just one bit of information. So there is a fixing of that bit that you can move to a low deficiency one subsource of x on which the sun of u bit is fixed. And then you can do it again and again, because now this guy will try to figure out who is its good sun according to a similar test. And a similar argument, you know, you can just lose one in the deficiency log n times and make sure that you actually fix it.
So you choose either as entropy or fixed, whatever happens with most and half.
Exactly. And for the purpose of extractors, just you can look at convex combination. It's really a convex combination of thing stuff. But, right.
So you don't need to lose anything.
Exactly. But I don't mind losing. Exactly. So anyhow, Q observed is fixed. This is one thing. So Q observed is fixed. We want all of this to be fixed. So this guy is fixed in the sense that you move to a deficiency log n subsource of x alpha to do so. Okay, so now you can't fix this thing, right? Because as we said, y, so this thing gives you all of y just by the root. So I won't fix this now. Let's wait with
vi xy.
Exactly. So vi xy, for any I that is larger than iv mid, you can apply the same argument. Because you fixed the left hand of v mid, so below it, the decision is based only on y this time, not on x. It's the same, it's just showing that p observed xy below v bottom is just also can also be fixed by the same argument. So this thing is fixed. And moreover, so you still have x here and y here, so you still are not done. But you know, vi, since vi, this fixed string is always, so you fixed x of left sun v mid, right? And so it's some string, like 1, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, some fixed string. So now we look at x restricted on some block, but that block is also always inside this fixed string, because vi of xy is always inside v mid, it's in the left sun. So the block that you are looking on is fixed in some fixed string, so it's just fixed. So anyhow, all of this is a function only of y.
The left side is fixed and
yeah.
I is fixed.
So vi is, yeah. Right, so vi is vi is you can think of it as a function only of y, but you can fix it just at one bit. You won't, so you can fix it like you fixed all of q observed. You can just fix all of p observed, namely fixing all of vi's.
So the index is fixed and the
so the string in general is not fixed. In general is not fixed, but
the
vi is exactly
string,
exactly
the index lives in.
Exactly is fixed. So it's just a fixed thing.
Okay.
So in y you fix the index set but not the y.
Right.
In x you
fix everything.
Yeah, not just the index set but yeah, exactly just the index set and the values are fixed.
Right.
And now because of this the NPC
is a function only of y. So this gives you a lot of information on y, but NPC on some function of y.
So the y is not there, but it's only
right. But you only get some small number of bits. Exactly. Exactly. Once you killed one of them, you use the fact that this is low, small, short. And right. So this is why above vmid things will work. Below vmid things will fail. I mean, sorry. The test will fail. And now what happened with vmid? We haven't really used the structure of the NPC so far. Just we used a bit, but not
the. So the last step is that you apply some thing like efficiency one on the y.
Right, exactly.
Or
on the y's, yeah, because the vi depends on it's depend only on y. Like this depends on your next before. And then
it depends only on y. So how do you get it?
Ah, because it's a short string that depends only on y.
Uh-huh.
So there is a fixing of that.
Okay.
In fact, most fixing.
So
right, and then you apply that. Now this is fixed, and the channel response mechanism tells you that you can further move to subsources to. Right.
So what happened? I understand that below we're okay.
We're okay. No, just we just delve on that for a second, and now I want to talk about vmid itself
okay.
for 3 minutes.
Yeah.
So what's happened? So what's going on with vmid? This is just a final thing. So I mean, just so. Okay, so let's just write it down. Oh, it's written down, great. So now you have this thing, right? You want to make sure that when you apply the response on x and y, or the subsource that you got so far, with the NPC of x v mid, y cubes, etc., you get has entropy by the response mechanism. And so let's recall what is the NPC. So in this case, when you apply it with v mid and cubes, so this is just a matrix, right? And at any row, at row I, what you have here is block extractor of y. So let's write it as ui of x and y. So ui is the ith vertex in cubes, right? And x vmid. Right, this is the ith row according to the definition of the node path challenge. If you apply it with q observed xy that has node u1 till u log n, then at the ith row you will see y with ui xy. And the weak source will be x of the node that you are talking about. In particular, when you look at I, which is like the depth of v top, right? Here we use v top. What you have here is actually u top, because we have probability ui is just u top. And this is great because this is a weak source. We just fix its left part. So it's still a weak source. It was a block source. And this, for the same reason, is a block source from before. When you talked about the output, how to output things. I mean, here it's kind of, we should be careful because you fixed the left part of u mid. But anyhow, u top, like before, but with the discussion on v, u top, if you fix something in its block, in its left block, and, but keep the entropy, it's still a block source. So this row will be uniform even in low deficiency subsources. Because, and so this thing will have entropy to convince the response mechanism to say has entropy. Right, because I'm fixing the u mid in order to fix these guys. One of these guys.
So you need the entropy from the top.
Right. I needed the block source, the left block of v top to have a block source inside of it so I can fix. Right. Okay, so sorry for storing time. Thank you.